Hello, this is the AI Lab. Today it's my pleasure to welcome Jurgen Gravestein. Jurgen is a writer, conversation designer, and AI consultant. He works at the Conversation Design Institute, the world's leading training and certification institute in conversational AI. He also runs a successful Substack newsletter, Teaching Computers How to Talk, providing readers with valuable insights on everything that's happening in the world of conversational AI. The reason? A blog post by Jurgen on his Substack delving into the intelligence paradox. Let's hear what Jurgen has to say. So Jurgen, in your blog post, you discussed the confusion surrounding AI capabilities and human cognition, which you attribute to the language used to describe AI. So could you explain how this language has led to misconceptions and also the so-called intelligence paradox?
Sure. So what's really interesting about chatbots and AI is that for the first time in human history, we have technology talking back at us. And that's doing a lot of interesting things to our brains. And in the 1960s, there was an experiment with chatbot Eliza, which was a very simple pre-programmed chatbot that had a few simple responses. But interestingly enough, people started to treat that chatbot as a human, or thought this chatbot was a human that they were talking to. And it showed that when people are talking to technology and technology talks back, we're quite easily fooled by that technology. And that has to do with language fluency and how we perceive language. Language is a very powerful tool. We grow up with it from a very young age. We learn how to talk. Talk as through history, I think, helped us thrive as humanity. And the interesting thing is that there's a correlation between perceived intelligence and language fluency. It's not a hard science, I would say, more kind of a social phenomenon that I like to call the intelligence paradox. And you can see that with, for example, people that have speech impediments. Even though they can be very bright and intelligent people, if you are someone with a speech impediment, you might be treated with differently just because of the way you speak, and that's because people perceive you as less smart just because you are less fluent in how you're able to express yourself. And the interesting thing is that also works the other way around. With AI and chatbots, especially ChatGPT, we saw that chatbots can now respond in extremely fluent language, very flexibly. They have, that's what it looks like at least, an answer to everything. They can even play the role of someone else if you want, or assume the role of someone else. And as a result of that, we perceive them as pretty smart, smarter than they actually are, in fact. And I think this leads to a confusion, and we've seen that, I think, over the past year. It does basically two things. So we tend to overestimate the capabilities of these systems because of their language fluency, and we perceive them as smarter than they really are. And it leads to confusion also, I would say, about how the technology actually works. So by over-attributing qualities to these systems, we tend to think that they are as smart as people or learn as quickly as people. Then there's people that suggest they might have feelings like we do or similar to we do. Or a theory of mind, or there's even people that suggest chatbots could be conscious. So I think that all ties into this this fact that language and language fluency has a really big effect on us, and that's how we look at things and how we look through the world.
Thank you, Jurgen. You actually made me think that's actually how lobbyists also function, language fluency, and we hope that they think we're intelligent. So your article also highlights the notion of conceptual borrowing, where terms from human psychology, like hallucinations, are applied to AI, that leads to further confusion. Can you delve into how this impacts public perception and also maybe the actual understanding of AI?
Yeah, so this comes out of a research article that I read. It's from two professors, Luciano Floridi and Anna Nombre. They're from Yale and Oxford. They wrote a research article kind of explaining this concept of conceptual borrowing and like matching that to what's happening in AI right now. And they literally wrote, quote unquote, AI has ended up describing computers anthropomorphically. So as computational brains with psychological properties, while brain and cognitive sciences have ended up describing brains and minds computationally and or informationally, almost like biological computers. And I think this again ties back to this concept that language and how we speak about things informs how we think about the things that are being described by the language. And similar to the intelligence paradox, it can lead to confusion about how technology actually works. It can lead to confusion about whether we underestimate or overestimate the impact of a certain technology. And that, in turn, informs how we make policies or regulate certain technologies now or in the future. So again, being conscious of language and how language informs how we view technology is, I think, essential, not just as somebody that works in technology, but especially if you're on the first line and you're a policymaker and you have to work and think about that. And maybe an interesting example to show you what, like a small example of conceptual borrowing would be the term hallucinations. It became kind of a common term to describe when systems like ChatGPT say something that sounds very authoritative and sounds very correct and precise, but is actually made up of or partly confabulated. And again, here the language fluency comes back into the picture, because it sounds very accurate what they're saying. It looks like it has the shape of a right response, but they often smuggle in details that are not really correct. This actually has nothing to do with real hallucinations, like hallucinations as we know them to be in humans. Hallucinations in technology or in ChatGPT or similar systems have to do with statistical patterns that don't match up with the question that's being asked. So the response or that is predicted does not match what with the data that the AI is trained on. Has nothing to do with like that original psychological effect that we used to use the word hallucinations for. And I don't know if it's that impactful in terms of this example, that impactful in terms of that it's completely misguiding us. But it is a clear example of where we are mixing up language from one field to the other. And now it's become kind of a commonplace word to describe this effect.
Thank you, Jurgen. I believe that I read a comment that you made to someone where the words confabulation and then BS, not to spell it out, were deemed more appropriate to qualify the behavior of AI when they just make up things. In your blog, you also mentioned the differences in how humans and AI learn and the implications of these differences. Could you elaborate on why it's misleading to use the term learning for AI processes and what this means for the future of AI development?
Yeah, again, if you talk about conceptual borrowing, machine learning is a great example of that too. Learning, I mean, if you look at how a child learns, that's very different from how machine learning systems learn. In machine learning systems, we give the machine a lot of data and then it's training for a long time on all the data, and then you get kind of a system out of it. That's very, very different from how a child grows up and learns about the world. I think if you think about it, a child learns very experimentally. I don't know exactly when a child learns to speak, but a lot of the learning happens before we even have the words to describe the things that we're learning. A child, for example, learns how to stack a block or a few blocks before it can reason about stacking certain blocks in that regard. So again, there's a very, I think, big discrepancy between what learning is in the psychological terms and the biological terms when we talk about learning, and then when it comes to this these systems. And then if you talk about, like, where's the harm in that? Arguably, there's not that much harm in it. Otherwise, if people conflate the two. So if you actually start to be convinced that LLMs are as smart and learn as quickly as people or children, you again could get the idea that the line just shoots up, like these systems will get infinitely smarter very fast, and maybe we should do something about that very quickly. Again, you could be over-attributing qualities to these systems. An interesting benchmark that was recently launched by it's kind of a prize or a challenge. It's called the ARC AGI Challenge, ARC Prize. There's a $1 million prize pool for the first person that can build an AI to solve a new benchmark that they created. And this benchmark consists of very simple puzzles that a five-year-old, visual puzzles that a five-year-old could basically solve. And it turns out that AI very much struggles with this benchmark, and it hasn't been solved yet. It's been now, the prize pool has been live for a few months now. And what's really interesting about that is that this benchmark or this test does not rely on stored knowledge in the system. So ChatGPT cannot rely on all the data basically that it has been trained on. To solve these little puzzles, it would have to kind of reason or invent kind of a way to solve that problem. It would need to learn how to learn something new, actually. As kids and as people, we are really good at that. If we see something that we haven't seen before, we kind of try to generalize ideas from the things that we do know, and we apply this to this novel problem. So I think that's again an interesting way to look at learning, and especially where this is where these systems fall short. They can reason based on the data that they've seen, but as soon as it kind of goes out of the distribution of what they've seen in their data set, they will struggle with whatever task they're being asked to perform. And again, that's very different from how we operate in the world.
Thank you, Jurgen. I think that's very clear and very reassuring for all the people that think that AI is going to take away all jobs immediately. At least we can still solve our own puzzles. That's good news. Thank you so much. I encourage everyone to read Jurgen's newsletters and blog posts. The link will be in the description. And I'm certainly enjoying reading them and look forward to learning more about how conversations happen in AI. Thank you so much.
Thank you for having me.